like to give us a chance to meditate on the words living authentically. All week, I must tell you, I've been listening to Democratic convocation, and many things have been said and many things have touched my heart, but there's been one phrase that has been echoing in my heart and my mind again and again and again. It's come from our former president, Barack Obama. He uttered them when he said, "This is not an ordinary time." These words are so true. And as his beautiful wife, former First Lady Michelle Obama, she then went in her speech and she said these words. She said, "Our world today is filled with people shouting in grocery stores because people are willing to wear masks to keep us safe. People are calling the police on folks minding their own business just because of the color of their skin." She says there's a sense of entitlement that only certain people belong here, and greed is good and winning is everything because as long as you get what you want, it's okay, and to top, and it doesn't matter what anyone else needs or cares about. Doesn't that sound a little true too? When you add these truths that they speak with a pandemic and economic crisis and political upheaval, racism and every other ism or whatever else you can think of that is dark, evil, hurt-filled, it just reminds us in so many ways we are not living in normal times. And although we are not living in a normal time, and this is not a normal time, I want to share and remind us we are not normal people. In fact, we're not normal people. We are uniquely made, fearfully and wonderfully created by God. We are peculiar, very peculiar. In fact, some people might want to call us strange. We just don't fit in with the rest of the world like they do. And the other truth is that even though we are peculiar, we are different and diverse, beautiful in all the ways that God has made us. And although we live in this world, we're not exactly peculiar. We are alive with Christ. We have the Spirit of Christ dwelling in us. And because the Spirit of God is greater than any enemy that is surrounding us, we are not a normal people. And so today, to the unique, peculiar, not exactly normal people that don't fit in the world exactly like the rest of the world, but I want to remind you and share with you. And I want to do as Paul did. In the first, in chapter 12. I want to appeal to you first, and then I want to take a moment to do what I hope you will do in your own time. When you get before your devotional time, I pray that you break open the scriptures and see what jumps out at you, because this is just what jumped out at me today. And so, as Paul said, I appeal to you therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So, beloved, I invite you, as Paul invited that beautiful, diverse community long ago, after he told them who they were, he wanted to say this. He said, as these unique people, living in sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, you who have a different mindset, let me remind you what should be the practical way in which your mind should be set. He said, let love be genuine. Let love, the same love, the love that shadows and reflects the Lord Jesus Christ, because you know, John 3:16 says what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes shall not perish but have eternal life. And this love, this is the love, this is agape love. It's not the brother love, it's not the sexual love, it's not the love that you give to family and friends. This is a different kind of love, and this love is supposed to be genuine. Genuine in Greek also means authentic. Each of us are authentic, and we're called to live an authentic life. And living an authentic life, it's the way that you have been crafted and created. It is the way in which you're supposed to walk and show what have got caught up in this world, and I confess at times I have too. I'm working my way back to natural and being who I am, but in the authenticness of who I am, I've learned a couple of things. And I pray you check what you learned about you. In how God has created me to be, I'm actually an introvert. You would never guess that, would you? I just have excellent extrovert tendencies, and so I'm a little loud at times, but the truth of the matter is, deep down inside, I like to be quiet and spend time with the Lord. And in that space, the Lord speaks. And when the Lord speaks, it inspires me to then go and do. And so, in your authenticness, the other thing that's unique about me, and I'm sharing this because for many of you, you don't know who I am. And so I thought I'd share a little bit about who I am and then see how God is working with that. The other thing you'll learn about me is I'm very movable. I like to swing my arms and kick my legs because it's the dancer in me. I like to dance like David danced. And that's the way I've learned to worship first. Yes, all of those other things are amazing. That's what makes me authentic. No one speaks like I do, acts like I do. Praise the Lord, my mama would say. Who are you? Who are you without the roles and responsibilities? Who did God create you to be? Who are you in your inward self and in your fullness of who you are? Are you authentically living out who you are and who God says you are in this time and age? If the answer is yes, bless the Lord, oh, our soul. But if the answer is no, this is not a normal time, and it's time for people to be authentic and be genuine. Because the only way you can love genuinely is if you're genuinely who you are. And the only way you can love others is if you learn how to love yourself. And so, beloved, you've got to be genuine in this thing. Be authentic in who you are. In love. Love is not easy. Amen. Or maybe it's easy for you. Nope. There are some people in this world that make you stretch your understanding of love. There are some people in this world that makes you wonder, do they really know what love is? There are other people who are trying to be loved, but they haven't exactly experienced it exactly right, so they don't know what to do. And so because they don't know what to do, they give what they got. And sometimes brokenness heals brokenness, and hurt gives hurt, all in the name of love. But the love we are to exhibit is the love that was first given to us long ago. It's a love that casts out fear. It's a love that transforms heart, mind, and spirit. It's a love that reminds you of who you are when the rest of the world wants to present something else to you. It's a love that can truly change your heart, mind, and spirit. Genuine love, agape love, God's love. God's kind of love is like no other. It forgives, it heals, it sees beyond, and still sees the precious gift that's put inside of us. And this day, people who are not normal, you're called to love like that. You're called to love like that, and when you don't know how to love like that, Paul goes through a whole list of things that you should do. That list that Dr. Bloom read was so phenomenal. If this was a Bible study, I would walk step by step. But today, I want to highlight just a few. The few that I see need, this world needs more than anything. The first says, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Evil. Evil is strange these days. It's hard to pick it out because it's so prevalent before our eyes. We're not sure if it's evil or good until after it hits us and knocks us out. And we're like, Lord, what was that? But beloved, the simplest way to figure out what's evil, anything that is outside the will of God, anything that does not reflect what God's way says, that's evil. If it hurts and it destroys and it kills and it steals your joy and your peace. And right now in our world, there are a lot of evil things going on, and it's time for some of us to use our authentic selves and our gifts and speak because love does not let evil remain. And hold fast to what is good. Oh my Lord, what's good, what's good, what's good? According to the world, what's good is what's good for me, it may not be good for you. According to the world, is as long as I get what I want, then that's good. But forget about you, no, that's not good. The good that God calls in love is a mutual exchange. It's a relationship. It's about me loving and caring for you and seeing what you need and honoring you in all the ways and ensuring that you understand me enough to give that back. And in the exchange of love, God's love, God's spirit, we become iron sharpening iron, and we begin to build up one another and grow. And in some way change the world. And sometimes good comes in the place where evil is. And when good comes in the place where evil is, a couple things will happen. Evil doesn't always bow down very easily. Sometimes evil likes to raise its ugly head just a little higher and want to say, who evil is, what? The goodness of God always supersedes that. And so sometimes when we come authentically as we are to what that is evil, what will happen is one or two things. Sometimes evil will try to fight you, and then you gotta rise up and remember that your army, your warfare, not. That which rises up with you, that which you fight with, is so different than what the enemy tries to fight with. And when you walk in that authority and you fight with that, oh, you'll be amazed. And sometimes all your fight business is just you just stand still and let God be God. Amen. And other times when goodness comes to evil, it overshadows it and transforms it. In this time and season, it's time for those of us who are clear who God has called us to rise up and be goodness so that mercy can flow through our world. There's a lot of places that need mercy. There's a lot of brokenness. There's a lot of hurt. And it's not just in the world outside. It's actually in the church here. And it's in the church universal. There are so many things that's bringing the mind, the body, the soul, and the spirit. And so Paul says to them and says to us, let love be genuine. Let love be the healing balm that can transform this world. The other scripture that jumps out at me, it says, live in harmony with one another and do not claim to be wiser than you are. I heard it prophetically said, and she doesn't even know how prophetic it was to me. Sister Vilma said this week that it's possible to disagree and not be disagreeable. Some people think that harmony means that you like what I like, you act like how I like, you be what I want you to be, and then if you do it my way, then we're in harmony. But no. The harmony that is asked for us is to be in step with Jesus and to follow how the Spirit leads and to do the work to make sure that the relationship is healthy and glorifies God. To be in harmony. It means that there will be times that you speak and there will be times that you'll be silent. To be in harmony means sometimes you'll have to let someone else shine so that they can feel special. To be in harmony means sometimes you acknowledge what you have and what you don't have and let someone has who has what you do not have work together with you so that together the two of you can build and bring forth what God wants in the world. Harmony in the church looks different than the world. And we're called to be in harmony. I wish our denomination would get that straight. Amen. I really wish that our denomination would understand that the harmony is not my way and your way. God's way is never like our way, but it can be singer, but those of you in the choir, I think there's a soprano section and an alto section and a tenor section and all those other sections. And when you sing, if you sing your note, not the other person's note, it sounds beautiful and melodious.
Amen.
But when you try to sing what's not your note, choose not to. My God.
my God. Amen.
And God does things in God's time. What I discovered about God is so gracious and so kind, because God will always knock at your heart and bring opportunity before opportunity, opportunity before you, but if you don't say yes. It might take a little longer. I say it might take a little longer because I still believe until you depart this, I believe that in your last breath, before you see your Lord and Maker again, that there's an opportunity to change your life.
My God.
I know it's real.
Yes.
So if it is possible, work to be in peace with one another. And when it's not possible, agree to be, to disagree, but don't be disagreeable in it. Make sure that the peace of God that rules within your heart continues to be there deeper than any other thing. And let that peace transform your heart and mind. And as you live in peace, watch it transform those that are around you. If it's possible, as you live in peace with one another or those you encounter, realize that it may not be possible. You don't see no potential in front of your eyes right now, but one day God will do what God says God will. And in the meantime, don't get caught up on the thing that has not changed yet. Start to, as the psalmist says, sing and bring praises to God. Remember and acknowledge all the things that God has done thus far, and remind yourself that God is still working, even if it's not in a situation that you want changed. Yeah. And that's what I like about living authentically and being genuine, is that you can be honest enough with yourself and with your God and whoever you're bold enough to tell. That sometimes I don't get this thing yet. Sometimes I believe that this is what the Word of God said, but it's not yet before me what it shall yet be. But it's going to be one day. In the meantime, I need God not to take me like the world, because I'm not normal. I'm peculiar, and it's weird, and it's strange, and it's unusual, but it's unique, and it's beautiful when you don't act like the rest of the world. And it's ugly, says, because there's some things the world is not so good that actually reflects God's goodness in the world. When I took a deep dive in the scripture this day, this is what I saw. What I would encourage each and every one of you who is truly trying to decide in this season, because I think there comes a change in everyone's life when they decide, you know what? This is who I am. This is what I'm going to do. This is how I'm going to be. I'm going to live and die for Jesus Christ alone. And nothing can shame me from that. And so, since this is my call, and this is where I stand, I'm going to be authentic to what God calls me to be. The good, the bad, the ugly, the beautiful, the amazing. All of it dwells within me, and the Lord is greater than all of that.
Amen.
For those of us that are in that kind of space, I invite you to break open this scripture. Break it open whenever you get a chance to open your Bible, and as you look at it, read it personally. Read it and see what person, what situation comes to mind. And then turn the scripture into a prayer to help you and to help those that you are encountering with, so that they too can find who God calls them to be in the situation that you're from. And in the midst of it, what you may find is that the Lord nudges your heart and says, beloved, that's your job. Or, beloved, no, that's not for you. And when the Lord says, yes, that's your job, then you go forward in love and grace. Because right now in this world, I'm so mindful that there's too many inauthentic people. I don't know if that's a real phrase. I'll check the system on that later. But what in essence I'm trying to say, I'm clear that there's some people that are not real. They're afraid to be real. They're afraid to be who they are in the fullness thereof. And the Lord wants people to rise up to change this world. Some of us may have to shout it from a mountaintop. Some of us just have to walk and just be. And the only way by which you can go. So I hope your mind is made up. And I pray that you won't turn back to what you know who you are not, but to stay focused on who God says you are and go forward in Jesus' name. My prayer is that you will remember this day, or any day the Lord opens your eyes, that when the new mercies come in that day, it's so that you can be more true to who God says you are. And if you're not sure, have a talk with Jesus.
Yes.
If you think you can't hear me, have a talk with a disciple of Jesus who can be a mirror for you and tell you what they see so you can live into what God sees. The best way to be authentic, and this is where I will close, is to be in real relationships. A real relationship sees the person as they are today, but sees where they could be tomorrow. A real relationship is clear about who and what you bring to it, but it's also clear about what they bring to it, and as those things meet you, figure out how you will interact with one another by the grace of God gives you. And my prayer for this house, and I've seen it and I believe it's just going to go a lot deeper and deeper and deeper, is that we have good relationships, thanks be to God. We may not always agree or see things the same, but we have been committed to this call of Jesus Christ, and I'm clear that as we go into this next season and as the journey continues and as we learn to live it and tell of the goodness of God in our life, accepting all, recognize they're all worthy in this season. Allowing them to be authentic in who God has created them to be, and be authentic who we are, I'm convinced that God is going to do something amazing. Can you see it? I do. I see lots of people coming from all walks of life. I see people, some who will worship with us faithfully, readily, but some who make other communities and do God's work wherever they may be. I see this place filled with the Spirit of God, the people worshiping God in spirit and in truth, authentic to who they are. So there may be some who will shout and say, hallelujah, and clap their hands, but there may be others who will just rock. And as long as we're in tune and in harmony with the Spirit, it doesn't matter. That's just the beginning of what I see.
Yes.
And I ain't going deeper in it, Colin. As I go away from you, I physically disappear to the house on 312 Hussey Street. But while I am there and while I'm putting my physical house in order, it's an exercise I do to put my spiritual house in order. And it's a time of prayer and worship and discerning what God wants us to do in this place. So as I'm doing that, I invite you to do the same. In your prayer time, if you have not started yet, say, Lord, what is it that you want First Church to do? What is it and who is it that you would like First Church to be? How do you want us to rise to a new level? How do you want us to be authentically who you created us to be on this corner and this space to touch? What people in what places? How, God, who, where? Ask the Lord to tell you. As I'm asking the Lord to say. And then when we communicate, we'll see what God says. I believe with all my soul that this leg of the journey is going to be beautiful. But we need to be authentic in who God has called us to be. So may the Spirit free us to do it. And may we go forth in Jesus' name. Because we are not an ordinary people, and this is not an ordinary time. But we don't serve an ordinary God. So that's all I mean.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.